Cheap and Cheerful, and it's time for a quick look buyer's guide on cheapish thermal cameras. So I don't know about you, but for me, thermal cameras first came into my conscience with the 1989 film Predator. In that movie, Arnold Schwarzenegger and his Special Forces team face off against an invisible alien creature deep in the rainforest that's tracking them through some kind of thermal vision. And this was crazy special effects when I was a kid. I'd heard of thermal cameras, but at the time it was just some kind of wild military technology that I'd never get to play with. And this was pretty much all my experience with thermal or infrared cameras for a long, long time because they were so prohibitively expensive. I mean, in the 90s and 2000s, you could buy a car for the price of a small handheld unit. We're talking tens of thousands of dollars. And I know this because my old man worked in manufacturing for a very large billion-dollar international company, and they refused to buy a thermal camera for inspecting the machines simply because of the cost. Now, the reason they were so expensive was obviously due to the complex technology involved, but that wasn't the only reason. One of the other reasons was because thermal cameras are a regulated technology, meaning its export from manufacturers in Europe and the United States had been restricted by law to prevent its use by adversaries using it in weapons and defense systems. That's right, heat-seeking missiles like the AIM-9 Sidewinder that use heat-seeking technology to lock onto a target, then you've got air defense systems, special forces equipment, all very much using infrared cameras to provide a technological advantage. In fact, even today, you can't purchase or transport across borders a thermal camera with a refresh rate of higher than 9 frames per second. Any more than that, and you might attract the attention of some very serious dudes with very little sense of humour. But why 9 frames a second? Well, it's just a guess, but I'd assume that if you're using that thermal camera, say on a missile, to track a target, then you're going to need a very high refresh rate. It's going to need to update its image very, very quickly if it's travelling at Mach 2 and trying to hit a target. So by restricting the proliferation of such high-grade thermal cameras, the US and Europe no doubt were trying to prevent other countries from developing similar weapons and defensive systems. But of course, it's no surprise that today, China, with its huge industrial manufacturing base and massive technological growth, would be interested in developing its own technology in this area, making it more common, bringing the price down, and as a side effect of that, making it more available to the consumer market. So anyway, back on topic. In the last few years, and particularly in the last 12 months, the price of handheld infrared cameras has dropped significantly, with some units even being sold for under $100. But are they any good? And how much do you need to spend to get something decent? Now, I recently hit the buy button on a camera for myself, and I figured I'd take you through my thought process of what I was looking for, what I was careful to avoid, and what I ended up buying, and what I would buy at different price ranges so you can make a more informed purchase decision yourself. Now, for most people, the only place you're going to be able to pick up one of these for a reasonable price is from an online electronics store, and probably the biggest online electronics store, and arguably the best when it comes to price and variety, is AliExpress. Now, this is not a sponsored video, so I say that simply because I buy a whole heap of stuff on there all the time. Now, it's true, you can probably find them on eBay, Amazon, and all kinds of other similar sites, but let me tell you from experience, most of the stuff on those sites are sold by dropshippers, which means they list a product they don't have, and it's only when you buy it that they go and buy it from AliExpress for heaps less than what you paid, get it sent to you directly, and pocket the difference. This has become even more widespread now that AliExpress has gotten so good at getting items into your country really fast. Now, I'm not going to do a whole video on how to shop on AliExpress here, but the best tip I can give you to receive your items fast is to filter for the choice items, as these are already in AliExpress warehouses ready to go. So when these things first started getting cheap, it was looking like the phone-based USB thermal cameras were going to be the cheapest, because they were simple, they didn't require a screen, and often came in a very basic DIY form. But if you look into the specifications for those, they really aren't worth the investment, even if some of them are cheap as chips. So what are the specifications you need to be looking out for? With thermal cameras, it's all about the resolution of the infrared camera on board, with the worst ones, like this cheap phone USB one here, a measly 32 by 32 pixels. At that size, this is the kind of quality you can expect. This is a 32 by 32 pixel image, and as you can see, it's garbage. Others might offer 120 by 90, which is much better than the previous one and probably about the bare minimum you might consider. But honestly, I try to go a little bit higher, just like you might have noticed with computer storage, televisions, and generally most other electronics. There's always a sweet spot where you get the most bang for your buck. For example, at the moment, a decently sized 65-inch television is probably the best value because they make so many of the panels at that size. If you try for a smaller size TV, the price will reduce a little bit, but not by much, and you'll still have a far smaller television. So there's the sweet spot, and it's the same with most mass-manufactured electronics, including thermal cameras. So right now in 2025, the sweet spot for thermal cameras seems to be between two ranges of pixel density. The first is around 192 by 192 pixels, which will give you a decent image suitable for most hobby or home use. And you can pick one of these up for around about 150 bucks. There's even one going for about $100 at the moment, but we'll talk about that in a second. Now, for a little more money, about 180 to 200 US dollars, you can get ones with 256 by 192 pixels. And the ones in this price range often have other features too, like a larger LCD screen to view the images, the ability to save photos and videos to onboard storage, pass-through mode or visible light mode so you can see the thermal image on top of a regular camera image so you can really pinpoint the problem areas. Now, if you're going to start looking beyond those specifications, you'll find yourself getting not much more pixels, but a much higher price. So unless you need this for industrial use, then you might not need that kind of level of detail and features offered. Now, I've done the research and found three units at different price ranges that I believe are good value at the moment, including the one that I bought myself, which I'll cover in detail shortly. And so with that in mind, here's the short list of my requirements. Price, specifications in that sweet spot, honest advertisement, branded with a manufacturer store, lots of sales and good reviews. Based on that, these are the three units that I believe right now are most worth your consideration. Number one would be the Mileseey TR10. At just $110, this is unusually low, so it might not be available by the time you see this video, and it's going to make all my other recommendations look expensive in comparison. With 192 by 192 thermal pixels at that price delivered in 10 days, it almost seems too good to be true, but this store's got many more items at regular prices and has lots of good reviews. If I was in the US, I'd be picking this one up without question. Second, the Mileseey TR256E. At $160 before coupons delivered, you're going to get the more detailed 256 by 192 pixels. It's got lots of reviews, 1,000 plus units sold. This is a solid buy in my opinion. A lot of people swear by this unit, and the only reason I didn't buy this one specifically is because I needed a bigger screen and video recording. Okay, so finally, the unit that I purchased, the Tooltop ET692C. At $192 before coupons delivered, you get that improved 256 by 192 thermal pixels, a bigger screen, visible light camera, and onboard storage so you can take photos and videos and save them on your computer. In my opinion, it's the best value high-spec unit in this price range, and we'll take a closer look at it now. So the Tooltop comes in this nice hard box, well packaged, well secured, decent manual. The unit itself is quite solid with a nice protective cover over the front. The battery is an 18650 in the back, so it's replaceable if you need to in a few years. There's a Type-C connection here on the side, so you can plug it into your computer. See my warning at the end about that though. And of course, this nice big 3.2 inch LCD screen with both a visible light and infrared mode, so you can mix between to get the perfect combination image. Now we can switch it on here. Takes about 5 or 10 seconds to boot up when you turn it on. We need to remove the cover on the lens here. Now, first impressions were very good for this device. It works well. The image is relatively detailed and it seems to have a high enough refresh rate. It's got a trigger button up the front here. That's where you start and stop recording and take photos. Now, according to the instructions, I can switch between thermal and infrared cameras. Nice feature. Not all of them will come with that. It's got a whole bunch of features in the menu. So if I press that, I can choose different color palettes. As you can see, some models have lots of different color palettes, others have less. There appears to be firmware updates for this one. There's emissivity, so if you're looking at certain items that need specific settings, you can set emissivity there. Other than that, relatively straightforward and basic. Just turn it on, point and click. Let's take a look at some items around about my house. First of all, my computer. I was surprised to see on my computer the CPU and GPU were not the hottest item. It was actually the RAM, which makes sense since they don't have any fan cooling on them. Moving on, a good use for these is to inspect your meter box or your electricity box, whatever you call them in your country, as if you see a particular area that's glowing much hotter than the other areas, it's a good sign there's some kind of bad connection going on there, which could start a fire someday, so it's worth getting checked out. One thing to remember though is that the colors are all relative. So if something's glowing hot in the image, it's not necessarily super hot, it's just hotter than everything else around it. So, for example, I was reviewing a bunch of electric screwdrivers a few days ago, and I noticed that one of them was getting very hot compared to the others. Now, it's only 45 degrees Celsius or 115 Fahrenheit, so it's not super hot, but noticeably hotter than any of the other three. Now, looking at an engine or really anything mechanical or with significant electrical elements to it can be an excellent diagnostic tool when you're trying to find out what's causing your problems. For example, if you have a broken electronic device, you can run the camera over the board and see if a particular area is far hotter than the rest, and that can indicate that it's the component which is failing and needs to be replaced. And of course, should the predator come here to me in Australia, I can shine this thermal camera right back at them. And finally, a word of warning should you plan to buy this or really any other electronics online that you intend to plug into your computer. When I plugged this into my computer to get the videos off it, my Bitdefender antivirus detected the included software as containing a potential virus. Now, most likely that's a false positive. It's very common for the drivers and unique software included in electronics like this to be written in old versions of Microsoft.NET, which can be picked up as potential viruses. But either way, it's a good reminder that we always need to be careful when we're plugging in any new or unknown device into our computer, even if it's just a charge. Always be careful and make sure your computer's virus and threat detection is turned on. Even better, get something like Bitdefender for added protection. Even the free version works quite good. All right, now that's all I've got for my quick buyer's guide into cheap thermal cameras. Everything I've discussed is in the links below if you wanted to check them out. Please like and subscribe. It really helps me out. Take care of yourselves. Be kind to one another, and I'll see you next time.